Welcome to This Week in Morgan County. I'm your host, Russell Mokhiber. Our guest this week is Sam Bodkin. Sam is the CEO of GroupMuse. Sam, welcome to the show.
It's wonderful to be here, Russell.
GroupMuse, what is it?
So GroupMuse is an online social network that directly connects classical musicians who perform locally to local residents so that the community can organically generate its own classical music house parties we call GroupMuses. And we gave them their own special name because they're really not just concerts, and they're definitely not just parties. They're a genuine hybrid of the two. And the idea behind a GroupMuse is that we can come together in, you know, the warm, intimate living spaces around our country and maybe someday around our world to share some of the great accomplishments, the great expressive accomplishments that I think our Western civilization can lay claim to, and to build community around that shared experience. You know, it's about acquainting a generation with this great body of genius, but at the same time, it's also about building community in an unabashedly positive and spiritually nourishing way.
Why did you choose classical music as opposed to, say, like rap or country?
Well, I think that I personally started this journey because I fell madly in love with classical music. When I was 19 years old, I sort of had a chance encounter with a late Beethoven string quartet, and I'd never been serious about classical music before. I mean, I played piano growing up, but I wasn't devoted to it until I heard this piece, and it is such a enigmatic masterwork, and I listened to it on repeat for the next 2 or 3 weeks. And at that point, I had basically decided I was going to devote my life to expanding the listenership for this art form, because in a very short period of time, it added so much richness and depth and beauty to my interior life. You know, I grew up in the suburbs of Boston and, you know, had a lot of comfort and safety and privilege. At the same time, there was this kind of vacuum of substance and depth. And all of a sudden, I was pumping my head full of it all the time. And so I really came to believe that actually this music has an important role to play at a time where we struggle with substance and beauty in our world and the lack thereof. And so,
let's back up a little.
So sure.
You grew up in suburban Boston.
Yeah, Newton, Massachusetts.
And you're using the word vacuum and lack of substance to describe suburbia.
Yeah.
Is that how you felt about it?
Well, I mean, I think all suburbs are different. There wasn't this sense of a shared community vision around expression and around building something larger than all of ourselves as individuals. I mean, you know, there were a lot of fences and a lot of driveways and a lot of opportunities to keep everyone from crossing paths with anyone else, really.
What was the work of your parents? What
did they do? My father is a psychiatrist, and my mother was a molecular biologist, but had devoted the last 20 years of her life to raising the family.
And how did you get involved with music?
Well, so I played piano in the way that a lot of people play piano from second to sixth grade, I believe, but I didn't practice, and I was just kind of like, I wasn't devoted to the craft. And then I started going through puberty and I wanted to be cool and meet girls, and piano wasn't getting me any closer to that. So I actually picked up guitar and I got pretty serious about it, and I was in a band and we made some music, and there was a brief period of time where I thought maybe that might be my path.
Rock and roll.
Right. And I was upset. I mean, I was a true music nerd, like encyclopedic knowledge of every Beatles track, even the B-sides, Kinks, Bob Dylan, all those cats.
What about Queen?
I love Queen. I mean, Freddie Mercury has got a better voice than any operatic singer I've ever heard.
Are you going to go see the new movie coming out?
I probably will. Yeah. But
Queen is in your past now.
No, it's actually not. Okay. So I've kind of come all the way back around. So when I turned 19, like I say, I discovered Beethoven. And
you were in college.
I was in college, a freshman.
Where'd you go to college?
So originally I was at Colby College in Maine, Waterville, Maine. And then I transferred, actually in large part because I fell so mad for classical music and I found I wasn't being nourished in these ways. And so I transferred to Columbia University in New York so I could be really steeped in it. So when I first got into classical music, it was all I listened to. But I've since kind of relaxed, come back around, and realized that there are many different modes of musical expression, and they're all intended for different purposes, and they can speak in all kinds of ways. But I do think that classical music has a very particular power because it's very contemplative. It's very intricate and aesthetically profound. And so it's an opportunity for people to really dig inward while they listen to it collectively. And that's one of the things we talk a lot about with GroupMuse. Part of the reason we feel it's an effective social experience is because it captures the inward aspect of human existence, where people are sitting on the floor, often with their eyes closed. I mean, at GroupMuse, sometimes while the music is being played, it almost looks like we're gathered in group prayer as we listen and rock back and forth. But then the music ends, and at intermission, there's a level of conversation that far exceeds the level at the beginning of the night before the music started, because we all just feel so joyously connected through this inward experience. So that's the outward experience. We often talk of GroupMuse in terms of the inward half, you know, sort of contemplative, and the outward half, the interrelational aspect, the social aspect of community and human life. So that's really the line that we try to walk and try to satisfy both those needs. You know, it's like at a concert hall, yes, there's that kind of that sanctum of the inner space. You know, you're here to kind of worship at the feet of Beethoven, which is important, but there's not the space for the more outward aspect of human life. And so at GroupMuse, we really try to strike a balance.
The concert is more elitist, maybe, and the GroupMuse house concert is more community oriented. Is that?
I think I certainly would stand behind the latter. I think the former classical music organizations have tried really hard opening their doors ever wider. But they have struggled because I think in part the aesthetic of the concert hall, also the culture of the concert hall, which has been, you know, built over centuries of conditions, both economic and historical. And I also think, you know, the patronage base of classical music does need to be diversified a bit if we're going to bring in new audiences.
Mm-hmm. All right. So going back to how you started this,
yeah.
You hear this music at Colby.
Yeah, I was actually in my friend's basement in Newton.
In Newton.
He's okay. A cellist.
You hear the music.
Yeah.
You had been exposed to classical music, obviously, before.
I had.
But this had transformative effect on you.
It did.
This piece, which was what?
The Grosse Fuga by Beethoven, Opus 133.
And then you go to Columbia. Do you start the company at Columbia?
No, but the ideas are germinating. So basically, the most important influences were, one, couch surfing. I took a year off before college, and I traveled throughout Europe with a dear friend, sleeping on the couches of strangers in cities around the continent. And this was before I was into classical music, but it was a revelation for me because I realized how generous people were willing to be for the sake of a cultural exchange. I mean, we would crash on these couches for free, and all they wanted was to know us and get the chance to share their culture with us, passers through. And it really woke me up to what sort of transformational power the internet could have to facilitate those types of interactions. And then I fell mad for classical music the following year. And then I fell in with a group of musicians who were studying at New England Conservatory, which is in Boston. It's a world-class conservatory. And a group of them would get together, and they would, you know, get reasonably well inebriated and play chamber music at a really high level. Bach, Beethoven, Brahms. And I was the only non-musician there, but for me, it was a total revelation. It was like a breakdown of the dichotomy between enriching myself personally and like being with great people. Artists love to party. And so I really thought to myself, beyond being the way that my generation gets into classical music, this should be the way that my generation gets into itself, you know, gets into its own community. And so that was the germ of the idea. And then you sort of, I realized, wow, anyone who has a floor can have these experiences. I tied it in with the couch surfing experience. And that was basically the idea, to essentially celebrate the inherently social aspect of the classical music listening experience and turn it into its greatest asset as opposed to its leading liability. Because people don't stay out of the concert hall because they hate Beethoven. They stay out of the concert hall because they feel it's not for them. But when we're living...
It's a pricey ticket.
It is a pricey ticket. It is. Yeah. I mean, a lot of different organizations have all these kind of like student discounts, young people's discounts. But even so, people feel like that's not my world. But when you bring it directly into their world, if you say, what are you doing on a Friday night? No worries, we'll bring the Beethoven to you. All of a sudden, you've changed the calculus. And people find, wow, this Beethoven dude that I've heard so much about, there's something to this.
Well, let's do a little bit of the nuts and bolts of the business and how
sure.
You did it. When did you start it? How did you start it?
Yeah, great question.
And tell us about
it. Yeah, so I graduated college in May of 2012, already pretty committed to an increasingly crystallized idea. And I moved back in with my folks in September of that year. And I just started kind of blindly ambling towards this kernel. And I basically started by just talking about it to everyone that I could meet, anyone who would hold court with me. And I had a buddy from high school who was basically willing to host the first real one, and he invited all of his friends. I invited some musicians along. This was before there was a website or anything. And I laid out the pitch to the crowd. I said, like, this is a way to get into some of the great works of substance our culture knows, and also a way to get to know each other. Who here wants to host the next one? And like 8 people raised their hands. So we had one in 2 weeks. And then 10 people at that GroupMuse raised their hands and said they wanted to host the one after that. So we had one a week later. And within about 6 months of the very first GroupMuse, which was in January of 2013, I had been joined by 2 wonderful co-founders, my 2 brothers in this mission, Ezra and Kyle. And we were having like 9 or 10 GroupMuses a week in Boston. I mean, it really, the proof was in the pudding. And before long, New York City was calling, so I moved down to New York to do the same thing in New York. Kyle moved to San Francisco to do the same thing in San Francisco. And for a long while, those were the 3 centers of the GroupMuse community. But we've since expanded to 12 and almost 13 cities around the country. Chicago is next in line, and that'll be lucky.
Who funded this startup?
Well, 3 ways. Originally, I raised a little bit of money for myself personally just so I could move out of my parents' home through an organization called Upstart, which is basically a way for people around the world to invest in young people with big ideas. Then we were able to raise a little bit of private capital, but we also raised $140,000 through Kickstarter because once our community was, 30,000 strong, it really made sense to turn to that community and say, if you really want this to be taken to the next level, here's your time to ensure that possibility. And at this point, we're actually totally self-funded. We generate our own revenue, which is a total blessing because it frees us from the need to be stuck in the fundraising cycle and to kind of cater the listening experience to the people who are capable of funding classical music.
And when did the website go online?
Well, originally, before Kyle joined, there was this fellow who was kind of a guardian angel, passed through my life briefly, named Alex, and he offered to just build a prototype of the website. And that was in like March of 2013, so after we'd had a few GroupMuses. Mm-hmm. And that prototype showed that the idea really had legs. And then Kyle joined in September of 2013, where he really totally rebuilt the website. And so you could say the website in its current incarnation is from September of 2013, at least aesthetically. I mean, it's evolved in so many ways. And now it's this huge thing with, like a host dashboard, an administrative side, like the event page, and also how the musicians contact hosts. It's really quite a complicated machine at this point.
And it's although very pretty simple. If we wanted to start one here in Berkeley Springs, if we wanted to do a GroupMuse in Berkeley Springs, we could just go online, post that we want to do it.
Right.
And I guess people charge a fee.
Well, so it's free to host.
Free to host.
We charge people $3 to RSVP for the event. That's at the moment of RSVPing. And that goes to GroupMuse to offset our costs. But then at the actual event, everyone is expected to pay a minimum of $10 and as much as they can afford to give. And all of the money collected at the event goes to the musicians. Because, it's a really highly trained level of talent that that we seek to share with our community, and it needs to be compensated. So we do take a lot of pride in getting musicians, I'd say really pretty well compensated for these evenings.
And by pretty well compensated, let's say we wanted to do one here.
Right.
Where would in Morgan County, do you think from your experience, how many musicians are we talking?
Well, in Morgan County itself, I really can't say, probably not altogether very many, but we're quite close to Shenandoah Conservatory, and I've been talking to some of the leadership at Shenandoah Conservatory, trying to build a relationship with GroupMuse. And if you have a local bastion of musicians like a conservatory, then there really is kind of no limit to the extent to which the GroupMuse community can grow locally. So I think that holds for Morgan County, Berkeley County, Jefferson County, and then also Loudoun County, Frederick County. Because there's this conservatory, which can sort of pump the talent into the living rooms locally, and of course give young musicians the opportunity to share their craft and to make some money and also to build a local following and to ensure the future of the art form as a whole.
Well, let's look at a typical GroupMuse situation. Yeah. How many musicians, how many non-musicians?
Yeah.
Who hosts and how much money is being made?
Right, so there's a huge range of hosts. We definitely pride ourselves in having a very intergenerational community. So sometimes older folks host, mostly it's millennials, folks in their 20s or 30s, and they'll come forward. They tend to not be musicians. They invite all their friends along who tend to not be musicians. Friends from the wider GroupMuse community can always just RSVP. So in that sense, each event is a community building opportunity. On the one hand, hosts bringing along their friends. On the other hand, half of the crowd being made up of GroupMuse regulars. The musicians tend to be conservatory or in their 20s, you know, young musicians. And the ensemble size ranges from a soloist to a string quartet and occasionally larger. We assign ensembles based on the size of the living room. So if you say you can fit 45 people crammed in tight, then we'll get you a string quartet. If you can fit 10 people because you live in like a Manhattan shoebox, that's fine. We'll get you a soloist, and some of the great music that's ever been written was written for solo violin or solo cello. So there's a flexibility that lends itself to this dynamism. And that's actually, to answer a question that you asked earlier, a major part of why we focus on classical music, because it has that portability and that flexibility. I mean, people think of classical music as being kind of antiquated. It's actually the very opposite. It is music that can only be realized in the present moment, and all of the instruments are acoustic. So there's no amplification, there's no equipment van, the neighbors never complain, the musicians just carry their instruments on their backs, set up shop in the middle of a living room, and it takes about 10 minutes to set up. And then there's like a 45-minute performance. So it really like couldn't be simpler. I think that's a major win for GroupMuse and its prospects.
How many of these are happening?
So we average about 30 a week around the country.
Is it U.S. only now?
Right now it's U.S. We have had a handful of GroupMuses in the U.K. and a couple GroupMuses in Brazil and in Denmark. A couple in Denmark and a couple in Stockholm as well.
Okay, so 30 a week, that's pretty impressive.
It's a lot,
And do you own the company?
Well, I own a chunk of the company currently with my two co-founders, but we are moving towards full cooperative ownership status. So right now there are only 3 full-time employees. It's still just us. It's a real skeleton crew. But as we expand, we want to bring people into that ownership structure. So the real ambition of GroupMuse is that people who join in a full-time capacity become, you know, full-time owners, and they eventually, you know, over years of commitment to the project, can vest as much equity as, you know, myself, the original founder. And we eventually want to see if we can bring musicians into the ownership structure as well. That's going to be a lot more complicated because there's not a lot of precedent for that type of structure, but we are very committed to doing things in a different way. We're not a nonprofit for the reasons I mentioned, avoiding getting stuck in the fundraising cycle, but we also don't want to be like a typical startup that just concentrates wealth in a few hands. We want this to be essentially like a community-owned asset.
And when you say musicians benefit from this financially,
right,
how do they benefit?
So the average musician walks away from a GroupMuse with $160 in their pocket. Now there is a lot of variance because if they're 4 musicians, they gotta split the pot 4 ways, but that's the arithmetic average. And so they benefit, you know, with a sizable return on a 45-minute performance, but also they benefit because for the first time, they're playing for a community of their peers, you know, and for the first time, they're able to create programs that really speak to their own ambitions as artists, and they're, you know, they have this invitation to bring people who are new to this art form into the listening fold. And I think a lot of musicians, you know, can get jaded. They play for an audience that's heard this piece by Beethoven 1,000 times, and they are just maybe a little disinclined to be surprised. When you're playing for a crowd of 30, 20-somethings or 30-somethings who've never actually listened to a string quartet from 3 feet away, no less, all of a sudden you're opening up this possibility of expression for these folks. And I think that's very rewarding. I mean, it's basically like a house party, but they're the stars of the party and kind of the center of gravity for the evening. So it's rewarding in ways beyond just, economic remunerations, but that's very important. And we're not going to pretend that, like, you know, that's not a major motivating factor for musicians who get involved.
Does GroupMuse filter who can hold a GroupMuse?
So we do hop on the phone with every host to make sure that they're hip to the mission.
Because let's say they're not. I mean, and give me an example. We've been talking upside. Give me a downside where things go bad.
Okay, a perfect example is someone who says, I've got a cocktail party coming up. It would be great to have some musicians in the background. I think that would really set the scene. We say GroupMuse is not about background music. GroupMuse is about foreground music. And that means that when the music is playing, everyone is sitting on the floor, or maybe in couches, but we really like to, for folks to sit on the floor and intently engage with the music. And so we do need to hop on the phone with everyone to make sure that they get that, because we're not trying to kind of accentuate this misguided notion that classical music is akin to fancy wallpaper. You know, it's about vitality, presence, and essence happening right in front of you. And it demands a degree of engagement. And when you give it that, it gives back to you all of that richness that becomes part of your interior life.
Now, we've been talking about beauty and happiness pretty much.
Yeah.
The country's divided and there's a lot of ugliness.
Yeah.
So let me ask you about the politics of GroupMuse.
Yeah.
Are these liberal enclaves? And do you see a way that this can help heal the country?
Absolutely. Liberal is a tricky word that has a lot of connotations. I would say that for the most part, as of yet, it has found its deepest roots in coastal, more affluent communities, and it is one of our big ambitions to transcend the barriers that keep people separate. But we are strictly, I don't want to say apolitical, we transcend the political because we believe in the value of connecting people on a more like emotional heart level to lay the foundation for conversations that can maybe happen at a more abstract or ideological level. So for example, after our most recent president won the day in 2016, I got an email from an organizer, a GroupMuse organizer, who said, we need to put together like a big resist GroupMuse and a massive muse. Our bigger events we call massive muses. And I said, you know, I really appreciate the activist energy and like definitely hold that with you. But GroupMuse needs to be a place for people who voted red, who voted blue, who voted green, to come together and share something larger than all of us. And remember that as humans, we are possessed of infinite mystery, and we are so much more than our ballots or our party identification. And so what I'm really interested in is the possibility to bring communities together to share space, to remember our common humanity, that which binds us, which goes below partisanship and even language. And then at intermission, and especially after the second half of the music, to engage in conversation with this renewed faith that we are all in this together. And we really all value the same basic impulses, beauty, connection, community, and tapping into something larger than us as individuals.
You live in West Virginia?
I do. I recently moved to Jefferson County.
What brought you here?
Well, the opportunity to start an environmental stewardship initiative. Permaculture is the buzzword that really put me on this path. It's an ecological design philosophy that believes in celebrating the Earth's natural abundance as a way to build community and to build resilient infrastructure, really, around Earth's rhythms. And so the opportunity to, my partner Emily and I got on the permaculture track in Brooklyn about a year and a half ago, and we decided we really want to devote our lives to this vision. And so this opportunity materialized through a personal connection to move to Jefferson County and start a permaculture initiative. And I was very taken by the idea of also having it be kind of a national home for GroupMuse on this large plot of land, a place where folks from GroupMuse Seattle, GroupMuse Boston, GroupMuse Chicago can all come together and be inspired, but also be connected to the land.
But why Jefferson County? Why this plot of land?
Well, because it's a seminar center, and they were interested in starting a permaculture initiative, and we fit the bill because we have experience in permaculture, but more importantly, we have experience in community building. And so they were confident that we would be able to bring a lot of people in to build something that could really sustain.
And how many GroupMuses are there, have you been doing in the Eastern Panhandle?
At this point, we've only put on GroupMuses at this center. I've just started conversations with the folks at Shenandoah Conservatory. And so I'm planning on scaling up the offerings dramatically over the course of the next 6 months.
And when you do them at your place in Jefferson County, how, how many people show up.
Well, we had one this past weekend. I wish you guys had been there. It was right. So fun. And there were probably like 50 people there. And over the summer, we put on a couple, and there were probably 60 or 70 people at each. And the real dream is that folks who go to those group muses, for example, they take a look at their living room, and they say, I could fit 20 people in here. And then we bring a soloist or a duo, and then a couple of their friends say, you know what? I've got a living room. I could fit my friends in there. And then we bring a string quartet to their 40-person living room, and it grows out in every direction. And it's an opportunity to really create a network of connected folks in this community so that we can basically build a world and at least a county that we're really proud of.
Have you had problems where people want to do other than classical music through the GroupMuse platform?
So I'm glad you asked that. Our only stipulation in terms of the programs offered is that half of the program needs to be standard rep canonical classical music, loosely defined as being around the concert hall for 75 years or more. The other half can be anything the players want. So if the first half is Mendelssohn, the second half can be Guns N' Roses arranged for string quartet. The first half is Beethoven. The second half can be jazz. First half Bach, second half bluegrass. I've seen it all. So we're non-discriminatory in terms of the music that's offered, as long as it has that sort of core of classical that keeps the essence and purpose of the community together.
You walked in here today with a ukulele.
Yeah.
And we have a local ukulele group based in Hancock.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, could people play a ukulele at one of these things?
I mean, if there is a professional ukulele player and they have a number of pieces by Johann Sebastian Bach, for example, arranged for ukulele, they can totally play that for the first half. And then for the second half, they can jam out, and I hope they do. We do have a standard of quality we hold all of our musicians to. And that basically means that you need to submit a YouTube link, a little performer's profile with a YouTube link. We take a look. And, you know, within 30 seconds of listening, I can tell as a practiced listener who is professional and who is just hasn't made the life commitment to it. And we really intend GroupMuse to be a platform to support professional musicians as they deliver on their ambitions to bring this music to the wider world. And also, we're ultimately not doing classical music any favors if we don't have a high standard of quality, because it already has an uphill battle. And if like a really bad string quartet that's never played together and has never practiced comes and plays pieces and it's like, you know, nails on a chalkboard, people are going to be like, oh, there's a reason why I didn't like classical music. You know what I mean?
People in Morgan County watching this, they want to start one here in Berkeley Springs. How would they do it?
You go on groupmuse.com, you click host, you fill out the application, and you'll hop on the phone with a GroupMuse team member, and we'll work hard to match you with local musicians. Now, I will say that this is definitely, we're in the earliest phases of the growth of GroupMuse in the Eastern Panhandle. So the thing that will really take the most time is finding musicians for each and every one. But like I say, we've thankfully connected to this wonderful conservatory, and I'm very confident that in the months and years to come, it'll basically be an inexhaustible source of this talent and vision.
Wonderful. Sam Bodkin, thank you so much.
And thank you.
For joining us.
This was a real pleasure.
And thank you for watching This Week in Morgan County.